Hello and welcome back to DiabloCast, your Diablo 3 podcast. Here we keep you up to date on all things Diablo 3 related and share with you our thoughts and opinions on any news and updates in the world of Diablo 3. I am your host, Dennis Force Duhamel, and with me as always, we've got Kevin Sixing Carlino.
Hey guys.
And Tyler Cyberdragon Milnes.
How's it going?
And we do also have a special guest this week, and he may be having a regular occurrence here on the podcast, Dylan Tempest Foot, and he is a good friend of mine and also a member of the Force Strategy Gaming team. So why don't you say hello to everyone, Dylan?
Hello, everyone. Happy to be here.
There you go. So he is happy. We are happy to have him. And today we have a few things to talk about. First and foremost, we've got some revelations from the Twitter account of Diablo. We're also going to be talking about BlizzCast number 16. We're going to be going into a little bit of detail about the Diablo3.cc interview with Jay Wilson. In that, they talk about buy non-equip items, PvP tournaments, endgame magic find, and a few other goodies. And then lastly, we're going to be talking about Bashyok's explanation of the removal of bind on-equip items. So with that said, let's just jump right into the first topic, which is going to be some recent Twitter revelations. Maybe a few moments ago, there was a response from the Diablo Twitter, and I'm pretty positive that Bashyok is the one who writes these. I could be mistaken, though. But anyways, it was in terms of the Hashcraft that they're having, and the Hashcraft is, if you don't already know, it's kind of like a contest or a competition where you write something to any of the Blizzard accounts, and if they like what you write, based on any questions or anything that they're given, then they're going to retweet it for you. But the recent Hashcraft Twitter post was, he says it's a Hashcraft-tastic bonus round worth 5,911 winning points, blah, 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 blah. But anyways, the point is, what we're looking at is the number, and the number is 5,911. And what does that look a lot like? Kevin, what does that look a lot like?
May 9th, 2011.
Yeah, that looks like a lot like a date to me, and this is pretty cool. I like that he kind of threw that in there. It seems at first like just some random-ass number, but it's kind of a forecast to what we know to be the investor conference call that's happening again on May 9th, 2011. And I don't know, what do we think? Do we think that this may be a beta, pre-beta announcement?
Possibly.
I don't know. It's pretty interesting.
Precursor.
Yeah, it's definitely something. I mean, I don't know. What do you think, Tyler? Why would he write something like this? What is he doing?
Well, I mean, just the fact that he's mentioning, you know, the date. Obviously, there's something going on in that conference call. I don't know what, but hopefully something big like beta, because that's what I want.
Well, there you go, guys. This is the kind of insight that you can get nowhere else but DiabloCast. I don't know. There's really nothing to say about it other than it's pretty interesting, and that's pretty much it. I don't know. Well, I just thought we'd bring it to everyone's attention.
And I just got done with a little conversation with Bashyok, actually, and as far as the Hashcraft kind of a thing that we were just talking about goes, what he said was he doesn't personally recommend listening to the conference call on Monday because it tends to be pretty boring business stuff. I mean, as we all know, it is the investor's call. It's not specifically geared towards us fans. However, he did say that it was certainly going to be worth checking out fan and news sites shortly thereafter.
So basically saying that we're going to have to do all the work and everyone else doesn't have to listen.
Yeah.
With that, I can guarantee Diablo fans will have an up-to-the-minute presentation on what's going on in that conference call for all those who don't want to listen.
And that's right. You're going to be all over that,
and
right?
I'll be able to listen in as well. So.
Oh, you don't have exams? Did you quit school?
No, I actually got an A+ in the class, and I don't have to take the final.
Nice.
How badass is that?
So with that, I guess we'll just jump right into the next thing, which is going to be discussion of BlizzCast number 16. Now, BlizzCast is the official Blizzard podcast, fair enough. And the last one, number 16, was actually in video form, which is a stark difference from how it's typically been in just all 100% audio form. Now, with that said, because it was in video form, it is much shorter than the typical podcast has been in the past. But also, in terms of that, this one was WoW-focused. So we can actually expect future BlizzCast to be StarCraft and then Diablo focused, and then hopefully when that does get released and when that does get revealed, maybe we'll get some more information. Was there anything specifically about the podcast, Kevin? I know that you went over that article. Was there anything particular about it that you wanted to mention?
Basically just that, I mean, what you just said, that it was shorter and it looks like it's going to be more specialized. I mean, and then I do want to point out that in the intro for the BlizzCast as a whole, they used some cool Diablo 3 art, and they used a little, I guess you could say the Necromancer made a cameo. So basically they had like a cartoony Necromancer kind of a thing in the intro, which was pretty cool. So, I mean, we already know the Necromancer's coming back, but I guess we'll get to that in a little while. So we'll hold off for now.
Yeah, so I mean, there wasn't really too much Diablo related in that particular BlizzCast to talk about, but the reason it's worth mentioning is because it was WoW focused, and this again leads us to believe that there will be future ones that will be StarCraft, and then for us, Diablo focused, and definitely looking forward to when that does eventually come. All right, now into our major topic. We're going to be talking a little bit in detail about the Diablo 3.cc interview. Now, if you don't know, Diablo 3.cc is a Chinese Diablo 3 fan site. And they recently went on over to Blizzard Irvine and basically toured around the facilities. I got to play around with the game and then did a little interview with Jay Wilson. Major things we're going to be talking about is bind on equip items in Diablo 3, the PvP tournaments, a possibility of that, endgame magic find, and then the return of the Necromancer and Diablo in Diablo 3. So first, let's just start off with the bind on equip item. Well, they're not going to exist. Diablo 3 is going to have no binding whatsoever. So no bind on equip, no bind on pickup, and also no bind on account or anything like that. These are the kind of things that you see in World of Warcraft, and that is not going to be the case in Diablo 3. So behind this, what's the reason? One of the main reasons that they're saying that they want to be able to do this is so that they can have gear be freely traded between characters, different characters on a person's account, or giving it to your friends or something like that. Now, Dylan, I know that you played a lot of Diablo 2. I know that was something you were really big into. How do you feel about no BO bind items basically being in Diablo 3?
At first, I had reservations for it just because the idea of just so many items being put there. But after looking at the article and doing some personal thoughts, I'm actually really excited about it. Either we're using the salvage ability to use, you know, as a way of using the artisan. So that makes me excited that the artisan gear is actually going to be, you know, decent. So you can actually, you know, make good gear, and it helps take away from just the pure randomization of gear. And there's also one other article that I really wanted to mention, that the whole idea of the whole, you know, like in WoW, the BOP gear was to get the best possible. And then once you got there, you kind of plateaued. Well, Blizzard said no guarantees, but they wanted to make it that they're constantly releasing new content and new items in the patch so that you don't have to, you know, plateau. So despite the fact that the gear can be traded, there's going to be new items being released constantly.
Yeah, it's actually pretty interesting because when they initially talked about the possibility of binding gear, it was initially going to be reserved for that high-end equipment, like the best of the best legendaries, if you will, and the set items. But again, in this article, they did mention that those are going to be removed. But as you specifically said, I actually hadn't, I wasn't even aware of that. That's pretty interesting. So they're going to, in an article that you read, they said they're going to be trying to continuously release content to try to make up for so players aren't plateauing.
Exactly. I just read it probably about 2 hours ago, and it literally mentioned that they can't promise it, but they the idea being to constantly add new items in patching, which in a game like, you know, Diablo 3, where you're going to go through the, you know, storyline content, a great part of it is, you know, acquiring gear and the replayability. And if you're constantly being able to work towards that, it really, you know, takes away, you know, doing bail runs all day, or, you know, how many Hellforge runs I did my wasted youth.
Yeah, no, absolutely. That's too much. And before we go too much further into this binding thing, because we're actually going to touch on what Bashyok's explanations were for the removal of this, I guess we can probably just jump on into the next topic, which is going to be discussion about PvP tournaments. So again, in the same article, in the Diablo 3.cc interview, Jay Wilson had mentioned the possibility of competitions and basically officially sponsored tournaments. So that's pretty exciting. Kevin, you looking forward to that?
Oh, definitely. I mean, you and I have been going on and on about PvP and tournaments pretty much in every podcast we've done so far. So, I mean, obviously, I'm definitely going to be into that. I mean, I'm really competitive, and I'm pretty sure you are, Mr. Four Strategy Gaming. So, I mean, yeah, definitely. And, I mean, there's just so many different things that we can hit on as far as tournaments go. So, go ahead, Dylan. I know you got something to say.
I just wanted to mention, I just found out that Tyler's not as much of a PvP fan. So I think that once this goes live, Dennis and I should we should have a little show match between the two of us and Tyler and Kevin and post that.
I'll go 3v1 against all of you guys. Just because I don't like PvP doesn't mean I can't do it.
See, you know what's funny though, we are maybe even if it's friendly rib jousting, we are giving Tyler a hard time about his lack of PvP interest. But I'm almost willing to bet that what's going to happen is Tyler's going to be grinding that gear, and we're going to be spending so much time in the PvP that he's going to just outgear us and be able to 3v1 us at some
probably.
Point. I mean, that's almost a possibility, and that's actually, I guess that would be an interesting topic for debate, because finding that balance is definitely going to be a big thing for anyone who is interested in PvP, being able to figure out, okay, how much time should I be spending in the arena as opposed to actually acquiring gear? And I know that we've talked about in the past the fact that it's our gear set up at level cap at level 60, from what Bashek has mentioned, is supposed to be a mix of kind of crafted gear, set items, legendary items. It's supposed to be like a mixed bag, basically. We're not supposed to be full craft or full legendary, and that's if they get it done correctly. So I guess it'd be interesting, because if that's the case, then we can in fact just spend time acquiring the materials for crafted gear and then just PvE a little bit and then spend our time focusing on the PvP.
Well, I think with that, even when you hit 60, I don't think you're going to be fully geared with your character with all the gems and skill runes and enchantments and everything like that. I think there's going to be a lot of grinding afterwards to really hit those, you know, peak levels of gear that people are going to need for competitive PvP.
With the end game also, I mean, I'm sure there's going to have to be some kind of reward for doing end game content.
Yeah, they're definitely going to want to try to push us into whatever content they have. I know we talked about in prior podcasts how it's very advantageous for Blizzard as a company, you know, the idea of hooking your players into your game and having them want to play continuously, having benefits that you want in all facets of the game. So wanting to do PvE to get better at PvP, or we even talked about the possibility of having some PvP rewards that would improve your PvE thing, such as maybe discounts at vendors. Although we're not even sure if that's going to happen. That's complete theory crafting. But that's just one of those possibilities, again, to drive players into all facets of the game.
Yeah, I actually find the idea of not having purely PvP gear kind of interesting, just because, you know, it means that you can't focus on solely one aspect. Whereas in, you know, World of Warcraft, for example, the best PvPers often did almost no PvE, and now that may not be the case, where you actually have to do one in order to succeed in the other.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, for PvP, for me, I did a little bit of World of Warcraft PvP after, I believe it was Burning Crusade. So, I mean, once I hit max level, I just did straight PvP and got all the PvP gear. I didn't even bother with endgame PvE content. I mean, that just stuff wasn't for me. But, I mean, boiling back to what we originally started, I mean, PvP in arenas in Diablo 3, I mean, basically we all knew that there was going to be some kind of Blizzard-sanctioned events, just like they do in World of Warcraft. So, I mean, seeing official tournaments, I mean, not only from Blizzard, but from other big companies. I mean, like IGN just did a StarCraft II tournament. And then, I mean, that stuff, I mean, we all kind of knew it was going to happen. So having arenas in D3 with official tournaments, even though it's not supposed to be specifically into esports, we know. I mean, we've said this numerous times, right, Dennis?
Yeah.
I mean, saying Blizzard is going to completely focus this towards esports would be kind of stupid, because we know that they aren't going to. But having tournaments, yeah, obviously.
And I think any, you know, real gamer just loves the idea of that, you know, being able to, you know, watch and participate in arenas, even if it's not as competitive as, for example, StarCraft. You know, it's just something that you can really throw out there. You can throw yourself into. It's competitive. Nothing, you know, gets A-type gamer personalities going than like death matches in an arena.
Yeah, that's the biggest thing. And even, I mean, I would say, I really like the setup we have here, having kind of different opinions on these matters. Because for you, Tyler, personally, as a gamer, I know that you enjoy kind of the co-op experience, and you enjoy the dungeons and the grinding and those kinds of things, and not so much participating in the PvP. But even with that said, do you think you would enjoy watching PvP? I mean, I've done some commentaries. Is that something that you found somewhat enjoyable to watch?
Oh, definitely. I think they're fun to watch. I just am so horrible at them that I always lose within 10 seconds, and that's where I lose my fun with them.
Well, at least you know your limitations. but no, I mean that's the biggest thing. And in all honesty, being a StarCraft II commentator, I can say hands down, without a doubt, that the biggest drive, the biggest thing that's keeping fans and people who are spectating the game interested and wanting to come back and watch, is watching someone better than yourself, watching someone who does things that you couldn't fathom doing yourself. I mean, and that's the thing with any kind of sporting. I use sport tentatively when I'm talking, even though I'm pushing for esports, I use that word tentatively. But any spectator sport, any spectator thing, it all revolves around watching someone better than yourself, because it's an amazing experience to watch, like, you know, professional football players who weigh 400 pounds run faster than you can at 150 or whatever, however much you weigh. You know what I mean? I mean, those are the kind of things. And it's the same thing with games. You watch someone who's just absolutely demolishing their opponent, has got incredible reaction time, very, very good hand-eye coordination so they can do things quickly in the game. Those are the kind of things that are interesting. The same is going to be the case with any game. It's the same with RTSs like StarCraft. It's the same with shooters like Call of Duty and Halo. And it can be the same with this action RPG. Or, I mean, I know there is WoW eSport competitions as well, so... It's all about watching someone better than yourself, and that's kind of where the excitement comes from. So I guess to kind of try to bring it all back home and wrap it up, the whole point is that even if this isn't the focus or sanctioned events don't happen, people are still going to enjoy watching it. So hopefully they've got that availability there with those replays and observation mode like we've talked about in the past. All right, so the next big thing in the article that we're going to be talking about is Endgame and Magic Find. Now, we've talked about Endgame before. We've talked about Magic Find and its role in Diablo 3, how it's still going to be around, but it's just not going to be as big as it was in Diablo 2. It's not going to be as central as a focus, because the truth of the matter is that in Diablo 2, you finished leveling more or less. You got up to between 80 and 90, which is basically the furthest you really need to go, and then all you did was magic find runs, and maybe PvP every now and then. But magic find was the biggest thing, getting additional gear. So what they mentioned in the article is that magic find is still going to be around. It's still going to be a big part of the end game experience in Diablo 3, but it's not going to be the sole focus like it's been in the past. It's going to be one of many aspects to the end game. Now, we don't know all the aspects right now. We know for a fact there's going to be some magic find runs. There's going to be arena PvP, and then there's going to be crafting. So we know those three right now in terms of what the end game is going to be. But, I mean, for all intents and purposes, there are more. And we know for a fact there are more, because he even said in the article that there are some additional unannounced systems. I know this is something we're obviously still waiting on. Now, magic find runs, Dylan... You played a lot of Diablo 2. How many Magic Find runs do you think you've done all total?
Oh, shut up. I hate you. hundreds of thousands, very likely. I mean, I remember 6 Ist Sword, 4 Ist Monarch Shield. I mean, having 1,000 Magic Find sorceresses. And it really became tedious. You know, you got so good at it that you ended up, you know, I remember doing it in my college dorm room. And, you know, I lure Mephisto to a very specific spot and, you know, just let him die. but so I really think that Blizzard is, you know, really listening to the gamers and be like, well, we don't want this anymore. We really want the more immersive gameplay, and we want to be able to, you know, get our items a different way. And what about you, Sixon?
Yeah, I mean, not only Magic Find in D2, but I mean, after they added the Ubers and all that stuff, so I think it was 1.10. So we had Magic Find, and then we had the key runs, and then because basically occasionally your mercenary would die, so I know that I had a gold find barb that had like six, what was it, added like 30% gold find. It was some rune that added like 30% gold find. I don't even remember what it was now. But anyway, basically, so I had key runs, magic find, gold runs, basically you run through Travancore here and there. And aside from all that, you could still do PvP endgame. And in order to level, you had to do all the bailing and the casting. And I mean, basically D2 was, okay, do whatever you can as fast as you can to hit like 80, and then just do runs for the rest of the time that you want to keep playing your character. I mean, like you were saying, yeah, they're shooting for something else in D3, and I really hope that they can pull that off.
It's exciting. And the charm you're looking for was Geats. That's how much that I did.
A rune. I don't even remember what it was. One of the runes. Like Ist added magic find, and then something, was it a goal? Added gold find, I think.
Tyler, where are you? You're a PvE guy. What the hell?
Yeah, Tyler.
Oh,
sorry.
Well, gold was such a, you know, worthless currency in Diablo. I can't say I have much experience with that. And I had I probably had, I don't know, 24 mule characters because of all my magic find, which is why the whole idea of, you know, a strong trading is so popular to me, where, you know, you don't have to, you know, like have dozens and dozens of mule characters, and you can actually, you know, manage the items you have and use that and trade them to other characters because they are all unique, randomized stats.
I just looked it up on our DiabloWiki.com.
It's Lem.
You guys are weird. All right, so yeah, I mean, it's neat the fact that they are doing this, and it is good because it's not, you're not going to be as narrow sighted in the end game in terms of what you can do for activities. Having options is really, in most cases, almost always a good thing. Tyler, I guess personally, before we even get into the beta and before we start these things, do you feel like Magic Find is going to be one of the sole driving things that you do? Or do you think one of those unannounced game systems, I guess you can only have so much interest in something that doesn't exist, but or even crafting, do you think that those things are going to take up more of your time?
For me, Magic Find, it was just never that fun in Diablo 2. I mean, it was just grinding. So I actually never did it a whole lot. I actually just relied on the gear that I got while playing. But I think with Diablo 3, I'm really hoping that this unannounced system that they have for endgame is really just that amazing. Hopefully we hear about it soon. They did say that they were going to release all the systems before beta started. So I'm hoping we get to hear at least what their plans are for it. But I think I'm looking forward to that more than anything else, just so there's something to do other than grinding.
Yeah, I mean, as far as Magic Find goes, I'm pretty sure that no matter what they do, they really can't kill the whole magic finding, like, routine, I guess. Because, I mean, no matter what you do, there are always going to be those couple of people, those hardcore people that want to make sure that they get the best of every kind of item. They want to have, you know, the perfect whatever shield, the perfect this, perfect that, the perfect Shaco, everything. I mean, so there's always going to be people who do magic find runs just to get the best of the best.
Just going back to what Tyler said, I can't believe he didn't find magic find fun. I mean, walking around basically naked because your gear has no stats in hell, killing bosses, that doesn't sound like fun to you. I just remember just like random spawns and just getting hit once and just dying if I messed up on a teleport.
Oh yeah, it sounds like so much fun.
I mean, it's all, in general, I would say almost all gamers are of the understanding that an end game grind overall is an enjoyable experience. It's not to say that I didn't do it. It's not to say that Magic Find runs is something that I didn't do, or WoW grinding is something that I didn't do. It's kind of part of the RPG experience, in all honesty, even if, as mind-numbing as it is. But overall, I would say it's pretty universal, the idea that that's not enjoyable past a certain extent. You know, you can only do so much grinding listening to iTunes or Pandora in the background until you're just like, what the fuck, this is terrible. But then that also goes back to the whole random system of Diablo and the fact that, hey, you know, every additional monster you kill, that's another chance of getting the best item in the game, or maybe just another piece of crap. But that's kind of how it works, and that's how they hook you in. So I'm not disappointed that it's still in the game, obviously, because I myself am probably going to incorporate that into my end game play, but I am happy that they're not making it so that it's one of the only things to focus on. All right, now the next thing we're going to be talking about is the return of the Necromancer and Diablo himself. Inside of that same article, Diablo3.cc, Jay Wilson mentioned that the Necromancer will be in Diablo 3, but you can't play him, so don't wet yourself quite yet. He's just going to be a non-playable NPC, probably someone you talk to in one of the towns, something like that. And then also Diablo himself will be returning to the game.
Yeah, as far as the Necromancer goes, I actually didn't know that it was the Necromancer. I come across him in the one of the BlizzCon builds. I think it might have been 09, the year that the monk was there. He's an Act 2 NPC, and basically you find him in the middle of the desert, and you have to kill some mobs that he just summons, basically.
Wow, that's exciting.
Yeah.
so yeah, I mean, that's you know, just kind of a tail end little throw in there. It's nothing too exciting, but for those fans of the Necromancer, he will be back. But I guess the biggest thing is the fact that, you know, we're finally confirmed that Diablo himself will be returning in the game, even though we've killed him umpteen million times. He's back, he's ready for some more, so there you have it. Now, we're going to actually kick on back to what we first talked about from this article, and the removal of the bind on equip gear. And what we're going to be talking about is a lot of people were kind of raging, or if nothing else, they were questioning, why did this happen? What is the point of removing binded gear from Diablo 3? Isn't that a good way of filtering items out of the economy. So the answer is yes, it is a good way of filtering items out of the economy, but they felt, according to Bashiok, that it wasn't something that they actually wanted to do. They didn't want that way of filtering items. The biggest thing, what we're looking at right now, is that salvaging is going to be the way we get rid of most of the items from the economy.
Yes, that's absolutely right. I was looking into the same articles, and Blizzard was mentioning that the bind on equip and the bind on pickup only was filtering out about 1% of the gear that you actually needed, because most of the gear wasn't actually upgrades, and they don't want to have to go back to, you know, ladder resets and all of these gear wipes. So, you know, like I had mentioned earlier, the idea of just constantly bringing new gear into the equation and making the artisan gear so strong is a way of dealing with that situation.
Yeah, so, I mean, and there you have it. That's pretty much the long and the short of it. It's that they felt like this is not necessary to remove items. Salvaging is going to be such a main focus for players. You're going to want to break down that gear so that you can get those whatever items the salvage gives you, so that you can create new things from your artisans, and that's going to be one of the major focuses. Now, when we talk about economy, besides obviously the gear itself, we have to talk about the gold. That's obviously kind of, that's the currency that drives the economy. But how are we going to be using gold in Diablo 3, and how is that going to affect the economy? Well, as we all know, gold meant nothing in Diablo 2. It was so overwhelming that they were forced to do ladder resets, for instance, to wipe gear and to wipe gold off of people's accounts. So gold in this game is going to be much more valuable, so they say. And how are we going to be dumping our gold? Well, artisans is going to be one of the big dumps in gold. Besides that, being able to respec, I believe, is another dump. Is that correct, Kevin?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that was something that we were talking about earlier. It would make sense. I mean, they haven't confirmed anything officially, but yeah, it makes sense that it's going to cost a lot of gold.
Yeah, so I mean, besides the salvaging of items that are going to remove things from the economy, the fact that gold isn't going to be as worthless in Diablo 3 is something else that we're looking at for a stronger economy in the game. And then also the other part of the article, or the other part of what was discussed from Bashiok, were set items. You want to go into some detail about that, Tyler?
Yeah, I mean, this is something that we actually talked about a couple weeks ago, you know, how they weren't sure exactly how set items were going to work, and it looks like now they have a plan for them. Interestingly enough, according to our poll, the top two choices actually are the two options that they're going with. And just to explain, so those of you who don't know, basically, low-level set items are going to be crafted recipes now. They're not going to be items that drop from monsters. You're actually going to get recipes and take those back to your artisans. And one recipe, all you have to get is one recipe, and that'll actually unlock the entire set for you to craft. You'll still have to make each individual piece and get all the, you know, materials for each one. But it makes it so it's a lot easier to complete a full set, because you don't have to run around looking for each one. You just have to get enough materials to make each one. After that is going to be the end game set items, which was the other option that they were throwing out. Is basically set items were going to be sort of an end game goal for you, and this is how that it's going to function, as well as still recipe set items as well. So there's going to be actually two ways now to get set items at end game, and that's about it.
All right, so there you have it. Yeah, set items are definitely going to be pretty interesting. And I really like the fact that, you know, we're going to get a recipe for, I don't know, the Forces Demon Slayer set of awesomeness. That's probably the name of one of the sets.
And, of course it is.
That one recipe is going to unlock a whole slew of things. And then, it's just about getting enough gold and acquiring the materials to make each individual piece.
And yeah, I actually think that's a really strong concept, because it adds a dynamic to the early game, where instead of like, okay, I'm going to be searching for this and searching for that, you know, and it's all random, you have an idea of what you need to get, you get it, and it kind of takes some away from the monotony.
And I think the thing that surprises me most about the crafting set items is it was actually nothing that was even shared by Blizzard throughout the times of what they plan on doing with set items. In fact, we only included it on our poll because my friend Junction 3 actually came up with the idea, so I threw it on the poll, and surprisingly it was either the first or second choice, and surprisingly that's what Blizzard has done with it. So, you know, maybe voting on our polls is given more weight than we know.
It's not surprising. They
read
Diablo fans every day. They want to know. They also spam F5 on all my videos, so thank you, Blizzard. I appreciate that.
Bashiok actually just put out a brand new Blizz post about, what is it, half hour ago, kind of while we were doing the beginning of the podcast, which I think we should hit on. Basically, Whirlwind is now a draggable skill, which is completely different how it was in D2. Basically, in Diablo 2, you use Whirlwind, you clicked, and you couldn't change direction until you clicked in another location, but then it doesn't really make sense because you had to stop and completely turn around if you wanted to go backwards. In Diablo 3 now, you can just click and hold and basically move wherever you want to go. So think of it as walking. So instead of walking, you're just whirlwinding wherever you click. And actually, in the context that he was using it, he was saying that he wanted to make like a Fury regen build. So basically, he's going to make it so that way all of his items feed to his Fury. So now instead of having to worry about running out of Fury, he can just completely and infinitely whirlwind around and just be a badass.
He just wants to whirlwind. Yeah, through all acts, non-stop.
There you go.
That's too funny. Well, I know one thing. My barb's going to wreck face, and I like the idea of being able to relocate your whirlwind depending on what's going on around you. All right, next we're going to be moving on to this week's poll. Now, first, a quick little wrap-up of last week's poll. Last week, we did ask what kind of follower system you would like in Diablo 3. First place was a system where I get to choose all of their skills with 37%. In second place, we did have, with 27%, what Leonard Boyarsky, is that his name?
Leonard Boyarsky. There you go.
I'm really bad at reading names on the fly. Anyways, that was second place, what he explained, which I don't even know what that was. I'm really good. And then last place was other with 2%, so that helps a lot too. So anyways, let's just go ahead and move on to this week's poll. This week we're going to be talking about locations. Tyler, why don't you take it away?
All right, so there's a couple locations that we definitely know we're going to in Diablo 3. New Tristram, Old Tristram, Cathedral, Chaldeum. But obviously there's a lot of places for us still to go to. And as they've mentioned many times, that they really want to bring the world of Sanctuary to Diablo 3 and really, you know, expand on all those situations. So basically what we're asking you is, where would you like to go in Diablo 3 and or its expansions? A couple options are going to be Heaven and Hell, of course. You know, hopefully we'll get to see at least one of these, if not both of them. There's Yura and the Dry Steps. Yura is kind of the place of the, I guess, the connection between Heaven and Hell through Sanctuary. It was actually going to be in Diablo 3 originally, but they had to cut it due to development time. So hopefully that might be something that we see in an expansion. I don't know how 2 years wasn't enough time to get that done, but... Mm-hmm. There's just a lot of other places that most of them are going to be the origins of all of our characters that we're playing, either through D2 and D3, Scovos Isles, Ivgorod, Westmarch, Jiansai, and stuff like that. If you want a full detail of all the locations, you can go to DiabloFans.com, and Jaxor's actually written a pretty good description of each of those places, and tell us which one you want to go to the most.
So there you go. You just want to, as Tyler said, head on over to DiabloFans.com. Make sure you are logged into your account and you can vote. The poll will be on the right-hand side. And actually, I think it's on the front page there as well. So there you have it. Next, we're going to be moving into the questions of the week. All right, so this week we're going to be doing things a little bit differently. We're actually going to be rapid-fire answering the questions. A lot of these have been talked about in the past, so we just want to, you know, make sure that everyone's clear and on the same page from this point going forward. And basically, if you ask any more questions that have been answered, we will block you and ban you from ever watching any of our videos. No, just kidding. So the first question from Tyler is, do you think the Necro will be a returning class? Dylan?
No, he will not. He will be a NPC in Act 2.
All right, and then Matt asks, will there be realms, Kevin?
Yes.
And then Matt also asks, and Tyler, you're an idiot.
Actually, I'm not an idiot, and if you're going to call me an idiot, I'd at least appreciate if you did correctly and say, you are an idiot. Thank you.
Grammar right, for the win.
The next question comes from Anders. He asks, will there be a beta key giveaway, Dylan?
Yes, there will be.
That's right.
And you'll find it. You'll find it at 4 Strategy Gaming.
As well as Diablo fans. Aaron then asks, is there anything new about the system requirements?
Short answer is no. The long answer is no, but you can assume it's going to be similar to SC2 and World of Warcraft.
There you go. Dylan asks, not this Dylan, but another Dylan, will there be an option to overlay the map Diablo 2 style, or is it going to be confined to the top right portion as we've seen in previous videos?
Most likely, no. There is the mini map in the corner. You can also bring up the world map, which is overlay. but probably a smaller mini-map overlay, not likely.
Next from Adonis, I guess that's a name. Will there be an auction house in WoW?
There is an auction house in WoW. You mean like an auction house like in WoW?
Dylan, that's yours. Go.
I actually don't even know. I think there is, but I don't know any firm data. Say yes or no.
Yeah, this is something that we speculated on last week or the week before, maybe even the week before. It might have been all 3 weeks. I don't even remember now. But basically, from one of the Bastiat quotes, we kind of assumed that, yes, there's going to be some kind of auction house.
All right. Next question, and this is going to be for you again, Kevin. Yeah. Are all skills going to have a cooldown or just some? And then he asked some more things about that same question. But cooldowns, Kevin?
For the most part, I want to say yes. Just about every spell is going to have a cooldown. I mean, obvious ones like our melee attack or whatever probably won't. And I'm sure there might be one or two spells or skills that don't have cooldowns, but obviously that's the exception to the rule.
And then he mentions teleport, spamming, and PvE, which is definitely not the case. We've talked about that in the past. And the next question from the same person is, nearly all of your questions have been answered online or in previous videos. L2 Google. Tyler.
Matt, so was the teleport, so look to Google yourself.
William asks, I want more AoE damage. Dylan.
Well, you'll be happy with the new barbarian change because it means you can just walk around AoEing.
Nice, very nice. Tom asks, will some of the dungeons require team play?
He actually said dungeons, okay.
Dungeons? Will some of the dungeons require team play? And will the game system be the same as in D2, like you join something someone made with or without a password? Kevin?
Okay, so these dungeons are probably going to require team play. I mean, obviously end game stuff probably going to be more suited towards multiplayer, but I guess those of you who really want to play single player could probably do it yourself. I mean, it's speculation, of course. And as far as the game system, it's probably going to be a lot different than Diablo 2. I mean, they don't want to have people with those ridiculous game names. So think of something like StarCraft 2 where you can do a quick match or you can join a game with your party.
Next from Max, he asks, will there be item hunts in the end game of like in D2 for keys and such, Tyler?
Obviously, items in general for Diablo, yes, that's the whole point of the game, pretty much. As far as keys and unlocking endgame content, I guess we're still waiting to hear what endgame is to see if that's going to be possible.
And then the last question coming from Robert, is Blizzard planning on releasing different variations of Diablo 3, such as different editions? Dylan?
I don't know exactly what they mean by additions, for example, but I'm sure expansions are on the horizon.
Yeah, and then I guess the only other thing to say about that is, yeah, the consoles may just be different variations of Diablo 3. So there you have it, a little rapid-fire Q&A there. Hopefully we did get to all of your questions. And yeah, there you have it. So anyways, also sorry for the little bit of trolling. It's all in good fun. We love you guys. Thanks for your questions, and thanks for participating. I guess that pretty much does it for this week's episode of Diablo Cast. So for Kevin, for Tyler, and for the new edition of Dylan, I am Dennis. Thank you guys so much for listening, and we will see you guys next time.
Bye, guys.
See you next time.
And take care.
All right, so
this is why you guys need me.
Yeah,
that's right, Dylan. You can't replace me.
I learned to Twitter. Learned to Twitter.
Yeah, no doubt.
Sorry, Dylan. If we don't make fun of you at least 5 times within the next hour, then you're not a part of the official team.
I would actually be hurt. You know, I might walk away. I might, you know, get some tears.
Go over BOE. We'll go over the PvP tournaments, which I know Tyler's stoked for.
Oh, so excited. Can't wait to talk about this.
Just so you know, Dylan, Tyler's our local PvE guy. He's not a big PvP.
Oh my god, I can't wait to face you in arena. Horribly.
Oh, the 5-second battle will be enjoyable for you.
No. It'll be like a 30-minute battle as I like kill you with like a low rank spell or something.
Don't get mad because I sound like Jonah Hill, okay?
That is so funny though.
Why does everyone think you sound like Jonah Hill? I don't see it.
I
don't see it. What is that even what are they even saying? You sound fat? Is that their implication?
Sound like a funny guy.
Now, question, do you have the hair?
Yes.
No, shut up.
That is exactly what I look like, actually. Being half Chinese, I look exactly like Jonah Hill.
It's understandable.
Oh, Dylan, we usually introduce by names. Are you comfortable with that? Or?
Yep. Okay. Yep. Kevin, Tyler, and Douche Hamill.
Yeah.
Oh, that's clever. You are now Douche Hamill from now on.
It's actually in high school. It was Douche Handle is how it was.
There you go.
Douche Hamill got turned into Douche Handle.
That's clever.
Yeah.
Dylan,
I was also Do a Camel.
Oh, that's.
Oh, I never heard that one. I never heard that one in high school.
Yeah. Do a Camel was another one.